Well, you know, this book gives us a lot about twins, about life, about the nature of what we're influenced by. What we're influenced by ultimately means, though, who are we, right? So the Peter Selgin in this, I was going to say novel, because it has what feels like characters, and there is quite a cast. This Peter Selgin suffers this book, celebrates this book, is this book. As you go forward now, it's an unflinching set of epiphanies or revelations about your life. How do the people you write about feel about it? How do you feel about it? And how do you feel about how they feel about it?
That's interesting. Well, of course, the two principal characters, other than the author, are gone. And they had died before I finished the book. And of course, you know, it's a terrible but true. It's much easier in every way, for a lot of reasons, to write about the dead than about the living. The question is then, you know, what happens? Does that mitigate our responsibilities, the fact that they're not around to sort of defend themselves? I think it makes for even greater responsibility. But as for how they would feel about the book, we'll never really know. You know, my father wasn't a particularly private man, even though he ended up being secretive. He was very rational, and when you ask my father questions about himself, he would answer rationally and tell you the truth, and he didn't seem to have anything particular to hide. I think the denial that is uncovered in the book, this whole denial of his past, wasn't so much a matter of hiding. I think that in some ways he'd embodied it. He really believed that he was not that person anymore and had no connection to that past. The teacher, I don't think he would be very happy with this book for a lot of reasons. I think that he was, in a way, not just in denial of his past, but in some ways ashamed and not wanting to acknowledge it and running away from it. My mother was not happy with the book. I predicted that my mother wouldn't be happy with the book for all kinds of really good reasons, but not the reason that turned out to be the thing that upset her. Because I knew she was very upset by something, and I thought of all the possible reasons she could be upset by the book. And then finally she came out with it. And it wasn't the fact that at some point in the book she is sort of revealed to be an anti-Semite, which, was true.
But with her story.
With a certain story behind it. She was a very young girl during the war, and things happened, and, you know, a lot of people had those. But that was something I thought she would feel very uncomfortable with. And there were other things, too. I reveal an affair that took place, and so on. No, it wasn't any of those things. I described the house as badly kept after our father died, the lawn not being mowed, the shutters coming, the siding coming down. And she was very upset because, as the Italians say, mi hai fatto un brutta figura, you made me look bad, like I don't know how to keep a good house. And she was very disturbed by that. My brother's...
That's quite a wonderful reaction,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, yeah. My brother's response is in the book, in the afterword, and he had, you know, as he says, something like he had two feelings. One, that he was parts of the book that he wanted to read over and over again and that he enjoyed, and then also at the same time he kept wanting to fling the book across the room, you know.
Which probably means you've effectively done what you set out to do.
You know, when you write a book about a nonfiction book, and I think, I'm not sure who it was who said this, I wish I could track it down, but someone once said that when a writer is born into a family, end of family.
Yeah.
And that really wasn't the case with the Selgins, because we all sort of understood that we could tell, we were all kind of okay about accepting talking to each other about things. We've always been very open and